we're making sure that we're not obligated to the inmate, that we're not dependent on the inmate. But that's why we're put in this position. We have to be better than them.
Because if we don't respect ourselves, we can't expect the public to. How you guys doing today? It's Anthony Gangi. Welcome to another episode of Tier Talk. Today my guest is going to be Brian Dawe. Brian Dawe, what are we going to be discussing today?
Today we're going to be discussing the National Medal of Honor Foundation and the awards coming up in October, the One Voice Initiative, which unites correctional officers across the country, and the American Correctional Officer Intelligence Network, which provides information and intelligence to officers nationwide.
So we have a lot to discuss. And guys, right now the show is being done at our old studio, Gun for Hire. So if you guys haven't, stop by. It's up in Woodlawn Park. Also, my man Anthony Calandro has a YouTube channel. So look up Gun for Hire. Check out his new YouTube channel. Great. A lot of good information about our Second Amendment rights. So when we get back from our sponsors, let's cover the event that we have coming up in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, mid-October. Stand by for our sponsors.
I wanted to attend a university that had an intelligence program. I wanted to look at problems different. I wanted to increase my critical thinking abilities. AMU offered those avenues to expand. Obtaining your degree as an adult, you're actually paying yourself and investing in yourself. You can't put a dollar on it, it's priceless. It's something that can never be taken away from you.
American Military University. Learn from the leader.
How you guys doing today? It's Anthony Gangi. Welcome to another episode of Tier Talk, a show dedicated to you brave men and women that work in corrections. As you can see, I have a guest today. We're doing an interview. My guest today is Brian Dawe. Brian, can you introduce yourself to my audience, please?
Sure. My name is Brian Dawe. I started in corrections in 1982 as a state correctional officer at MCI Norfolk. I ended my career as a state correctional officer in 1998. In 1994, I started working with organizations with correctional officers all across the country to share intelligence and information and best practices to make it safer for all of us.
And that's why I got to have you on my show. There's a couple of things we're going to be doing today, guys. We're going to be talking about some foundations that you may not be aware of. Also, an event that's coming out in Oklahoma, which I was actually invited to be a keynote speaker, so I am humbled by that invitation.
And
I can't wait to go.
You're coming.
Well, I'm extremely excited about this, and I can't wait. We're actually going out to Oklahoma City. We'll give you more details on that event as the show progresses. But in the meantime, we got a little bit of your history, right? Now, you're no longer in the profession technically, right?
I'm not working behind the walls.
Right, so what's with the passion now? Why do you continue to fight for what correctional officers need?
Well, I think, Anthony, you know as well as anybody, being in the profession yourself, that once you've been a correctional officer for a certain amount of time, I'd say 3 or 5 years or so, it's in your blood forever. And that passion, I've had that passion since day one. You know, the first time I started the job, like most people, no one grows up wanting to go to jail. I don't care if you have the keys or you don't have the keys. Unless you're a legacy, for the most part, people get into that line of work for the economics, the benefits, to get a job. And that's why I got into it as well. But I have to tell you, after about 2 years on the job, I fell in love with what I was doing. I thought we were really doing an important job in corrections and law enforcement, maintaining public safety. And I also had a great affinity for the officers I worked with. In 1988, I started getting involved with the union in Massachusetts, and we actually formed our own union, the Massachusetts Correctional Officers Federated Union. It's now the largest law enforcement union in New England, and it celebrates its 35th anniversary coming up. 30th anniversary, I'm sorry, coming up this year, next year. So I was heavily involved in that, and a lot of the work I did with the officers there, and saw a lot of the problems that we face. And what I realized is that the problems we face are not unique to my institution at MCI Norfolk. They're universal. 95% of the issues we deal with behind the walls. I don't care if you're working in Anchorage, Alaska, if you're working in Broward County, Florida, or if you're working at Calipatria in California or in Rahway. The issues we deal with are the same. 95% of them.
I got to ask you, can we go over some of the issues? I have people from the outside that just don't understand, first off, what we do and the issues that we face. So you're talking about national issues. What are some of these national issues?
Well, of course, the biggest problem we have, Anthony, is just what you just pointed out, perception. People do not know who we are or what we do. We've been the silent minority in law enforcement throughout our history. A lot of that is imposed by management by not allowing us to speak publicly. And that's understandable because of safety considerations. But in certain aspects, we do need to have a louder voice out there. We do need to address these issues we face. Understaffing. PTSD is a tremendous problem. Here's one statistic. On average, we lose about 11 officers every year, killed in the line of duty, murdered on their job. We lose 156 to suicide. What's more dangerous, the inmates or the job? So it's something we have to look at. That's one of the major problems we face. And when you're dealing with PTSD as well, you have the catch-22 problem. Because if you admit PTSD, they pull your right to carry, you can't work. And then to go back, you have to have psychological evaluations to go back behind the walls, and now you have PTSD on your record. Who wants that on their record in law enforcement? So we're put into a situation to not admit the issues that we're having to deal with personally and just have to fight through that. And that results in a lot of our guys retiring early, committing suicide. That results in divorces, substance abuse, all of these problems that we have to deal with. That's the personal issues that we deal with, and we deal with those every day. Now that you compound that with all the issues we deal with, understaffing, lack of training, all the new gangs we're dealing with, spice inside the institutions, contraband, new gangs, all these different problems that we have to deal with are compounded on a daily basis. And when you're dealing with understaffing, that impacts everything. That impacts meals, it impacts visits, it impacts programming.
Just the daily running of
all
the
of these daily running of the facility, when you slow that running down, you start causing internal problems with inside the facility. Tensions start to rise, and that increases your problems. So we face a whole host of problems on a daily basis, but nothing more important, as far as I'm concerned, than the perception people have of us. Because a lot of the issues we can resolve if people understand who we are and what we do. Budgets are released based on perception. Legislation is released, is made based on perception. If we do not have the voice out there for the profession, inside the legislature, meeting with the public, they have no idea who we are or what we do. We will not get the changes we need. We will not get the conditions changed that we need because no one understands it. That's my job now. My job is to be out there and to be a voice. Two things I do. Two of the biggest things we do right now. Collect intelligence. I work with officers all across the country. We have an intelligence network. If anybody out there is interested in helping us in the intelligence network, please get in touch with me. We can use your support. We can use your input.
I'll make sure, guys, real quick, that I have his email come across towards the end of the show. So please, guys, if you want to reach out to Brian, I'll give you the email to the end. Email, state your concerns. They'd love to see it.
It can be anything from how are you dealing with 12-hour shifts? We're considering going from 8 to 12. What's happening around the country? Has anybody else done that? We will put out an information request all around the nation, get back the information from those organizations, and then give it back to the individuals who asked for it. That allows all of our guys across the nation and gals across the nation to have a network that connects everywhere. There isn't a geographical area in the country we can't reach, and we don't reach now.
First off, what's great is, and that's what we're going to push on to with that one voice. I want to get to that. Mm-hmm. And I also want to talk about a little bit more about the American Correctional Intelligence Network?
Yes, that's my network.
So that's sort of what you're mentioning now,
yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. We talked about a lot of concerns, right? We mentioned understaffing, we mentioned officers' mental health and well-being. These are concerns that we don't just see locally, we do see these concerns nationally.
Absolutely.
So now you're getting these officers that or these people that work in corrections sending you their concerns. You're making, reviewing these concerns, seeing, okay, well, let's see, this is not just happening here, this is happening elsewhere.
Right.
So what do you try to do with these issues on a higher level outside of just taking the information in and making people aware?
Best practices. What we're searching for in all these issues is what has worked successfully. What's working, what isn't working? What programs are actually dealing with this? Katarina Spinaris, a PhD from...
We had Katarina on our show, guys.
A good friend of ours. She's a great friend of ours. I work with Katarina on the National PTSD Study. We helped get out almost over 3,000 people responded to that study. If you talk to Katarina, she will tell you that that's probably our biggest problem is the mental health behind the walls. And what we're trying to do is get as much intel as we can about all issues, not just mental health,
right.
issues in corrections, and get best practices out there. How are you dealing with spice coming in? What are you doing for searches? What are you doing to deal with the new contraband? How are you dealing with drones? How are you dealing with the FCC not allowing us to block cell phone calls going out of our prisons? These are all issues that directly impact our safety. And we have to find out who's doing it right. And that comes to the second biggest problem we have in corrections, beyond perception. That's data collection.
Yeah.
In 2002, the Criminal Justice Institute went under. Before that, every year you could get an annual report of what was going on in every state and the private prison companies as far as assaults go, escapes go, staffing, training. All that stopped in 2002 when the Criminal Justice Institute went under. And then when we had 9/11 and the Patriot Act came out, and we love the Patriot Act, there's a lot of great things about it, but one of the things it did do, a lot of the departments now stopped releasing information on the FOIA requests. My organization requested assault statistics from all 50 states. 13 responded. The rest cited FOIA, cited the Patriot Act. They didn't want to give it out of security issues. That's baloney. It's not security issues. They don't want people to know what's going on behind the walls. And as officers, we need them to know what's going on behind the walls.
Do you get a lot of conflict with what you're doing with management? Does management tend to be a little bit resistant with you trying
to... They're resistant because we're trying to get the word out there. And a lot of times, a lot of our managers, unfortunately, are judged on budget issues, not on safety issues. If they were judged on safety issues, it wouldn't be as bad. They're judged on, do they come in under budget? And that's a real problem for us. This is not a Coca-Cola factory. You know, what we deal with every day, people get killed where we work. This isn't a joke inside here. This is dead serious stuff. So we need to make sure that the public knows, that the legislators know what's going on. Prime example. You can look right now across the country, and you can ask any department in the country what their staffing ratio is. And you know what they'll tell you? They're going to tell you it's between 5 to 1, and 6 to 1. And you and I both know.
That's not true.
That's absolute baloney.
That's more than right now. We put a question that's like 1 to 100, 1 to 150.
That's correct. What they do is they don't want to scare the public, and they don't want to scare the legislatures. So they take the total number of inmates, and they divide it by the total number of staff, and they say that's our staffing ratio.
And they're probably not even all officers.
They're not. They just take everybody. Really? Yeah, we don't work 24 hours a day. Well, hopefully.
Yeah,
we're not required to do that. So all these, now the legislature sits back, and I'll tell you a true story. This happened to me back in the early 90s. We were in Massachusetts, and I was meeting with the Speaker of the House. And we went in there, and we were complaining about staffing. We had a real staffing problem. And this is literally what he said to me. He says, well, the ratio is 5 to 1, and you have 6 bullets. I should take one of your bullets back.
Like we actually
carry bullets.
No,
and like, this is the Speaker of the House for the state of Massachusetts.
Right.
No clue. Now, who do I blame for that? I blame us.
Yeah, of course.
All right? It's our voices that have not been heard. It's our voices that must be heard. One of the reasons I stepped out of working behind the walls is so I could be an effective voice. So I wouldn't face disciplinary issues.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask you. Was there that threat?
Absolutely. I was a union official. There was a tremendous threat of any discipline if you opened your mouth. Now, granted, you'll probably get your job back, but they'll get their piece of flesh, and they send the message they want to send.
Right, of course.
Shut up.
And it makes everybody else hesitant to speak
their
concerns,
right? So one of the things we did was I decided a long time ago that was going to stop. That we are going to be vocal, and we are going to let people know. And one of the things we're struggling with right now is getting that data. How many assaults do we have? Are the inmates prosecuted? Are they on and after sentences? Are they concurrent sentences? What's with your staffing levels? When was the last time you actually did training? I can't tell you how many guys I've talked to required to have 40 hours of training a year. They'll come into work one day, and instead of going to the visiting room, they'll go to a tower, and they'll get marked down for 8 hours training. Because it's not their regular shift. It's not their regular tour. So they'll count it for training so they can knock it off that 40 hours, and they're not getting their training.
They're actually being used to cover a post.
That's it. But they're calling that training because it's not the regular post you cover. And that happens all the time. It's a shell game.
Really?
The way we should really do this, we should really do a staffing ratio. It's called a post audit, where you go by every single post on every single shift, and then you can tell exactly what you have for your staffing ratio.
And what I don't understand is, and guys, I got to ask this question. If this is an organization or a foundation that's out to help people, I would figure that management should want that. Like management is going to want to say, hey, how can we be effective? How can we protect the facility? I mean, just that's why it keeps it objective. The officers, the inmates, the regular civilian staff, the volunteers that come in. So why do you feel that they are so resistant? And you're telling them that this could ultimately help us get what's needed to run a more effective facility, which allows for the programming, allows for the inmates' needs to get met. So I figure if you take care of staff, ultimately it takes care of the facility and how it's run daily. Why would they be resistant to that?
I've never been able to understand it. And I've had numerous conversations. And one of the things I've always said is, why don't you want minimum staffing levels? If you have a minimum staffing level, the legislature is bound to fund that every year. You don't have to worry about it anymore. Once you agree to minimum staffing levels, this is what you have to have legislatively, then it has to be funded. They refuse to agree to that. They won't even discuss having minimums. They want to have flexibility in the staff so they can move people. And I understand that from a management standpoint, but from a safety standpoint, that's bullpucky.
Yeah, they're. You know what's, again, speaking from all levels, I mean, we have those mandated posts that have to be covered.
Some are,
I mean,
yes.
There are no ifs, and buts about that, especially when you got to have those eyes on those units, those eyes on your staff.
The armory, certain place, your towers, certain places
can't. I would like to feel that as management, you have discretion, right?
Yes,
but then
there
would be certain discretion, I'm sorry, you don't have, and that deals with anything that's literally going to affect the safety and security of that facility.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're going to start making moves without really having that understanding of why these individuals
individuals are in place, because sometimes we have management that doesn't have that security background. So now they're given a lot of flexibility on decisions that could really affect safety and security. So I figure at least those minimum posts, those mandated posts, allow us still with a little bit of flexibility to say, hey, we're good, but don't move these individuals.
Right.
So it's more of they're taking the problems of the facility and making it personal, as if someone is
gonna... attacking them personally. We're not. We're trying to get more money for more staff for more training.
A lot of
to
make ego, it safer. Right?
Yeah. And but two, what we have to realize too, from the standpoint of looking at from management.
Okay.
They're judged on budget.
Right.
Right. That's what they're judged on. If the place doesn't jump off, if someone doesn't get killed, if there's not a riot, then no one cares about what's going on behind those walls. It only becomes a matter of budget.
Right.
And that's what they get judged on. They shouldn't be judged on that. What they should be judged on is, do you keep the lid on? What's your recidivism rate? What's your programming like? How many officers are you keeping? What's your retention like? That's what tells you whether or not you're running a good facility. Do your officers stay on board? Are they sticking around the job? That means they're properly trained. That means that they're getting enough benefit and pay to maintain that job, to stay there. You know, how many of our guys are gone in the first 5 years?
Oh, a lot. We're losing right off the bat.
Right away.
Better offers. Of course. Sometimes they get the reality of that first day in. It's not what they expected, but that's
a lot of it, too.
Yeah, you know, there goes that public perception.
That's right.
Now, you got this organization. Again, we talked about the Correctional Officer Intelligence Network, correct?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Again, you guys interested, I'll give you an email to reach out to Brian Dawe, see how you guys can become a part of
that. Yeah, one thing about that, too, what we do is, once you give us the information request, we put it out all over the country and we get it right back to you. All and right. Now you're a part of the information network. So whenever we have another request, and we get them all the time from all over the country, you will then get a request too. So we ask that you participate and you help your brother and sister officers. Take 2 seconds and answer these questions. You know, if you just went to like Alaska, I use Alaska a lot, they're great friends of ours, they're very strong in our organization. They have 12-hour shifts, right? And they've had them for years. 12 hours on, 12 hours off.
So 2 shifts?
Yeah. Most guys wouldn't want that. Alaska loves it. They hated it at first, but now they love it, and the state tried to take it away, and they went crazy. But you have a lot of other guys that say, I would never do 12-12. Well, here's a great example. Now I can go to Alaska and say, why does this work for you? Now I can tell these other guys, this is why they feel it's working for them. Now, that's a minor issue. That's just an issue of 12 to 12. But that extends to everything. That extends to you know, contraband. That extends to visitations. How are you doing what's working best?
Well, you're opening up. It's sort of what I did, guys, with Tier Talk. You open up a network of experienced individuals looking to discuss their concerns and try to see the pros and cons, but at least not go into things blindly.
Right.
You know, I'm sure what you're facing at one facility, maybe one facility has overcome it, or maybe one facility is going through it as well, and you guys can maybe work together for that solution.
That's exactly right.
And some people may recognize this by ACOIN.
Yeah.
ACOIN. So I think I've seen that acronym floating around a lot.
You see that? We've been around. I started ACOIN back in 2006.
Hey, and people can join, correct?
Absolutely, yeah. Now, we have individual memberships and organizational memberships.
How if somebody wanted to join, how would they get involved?
Just get in touch with me. You can go right on our Facebook page. You can get in touch with me at ACOIN1@AOL.com, and that's the number one. And we'll get you right hooked up.
Right. Now, it's very similar to what we've been doing for the last couple of years. So kind of on, you know, you guys led the fight before I did. I mean, I've been only doing this for about 5 or 6 years. But I felt the need that we need to have that one voice. Because, I, like you said, you know, sometimes there is that fear for discipline that no one's going to step up for. You know, I mean, I'm not going to step up on fear. I'm afraid I'm going to get disciplined. But
right.
Having said that, the same problems you're facing, let's say, in Michigan, are the same problems I'm facing in Texas. You speak for me, I speak for you.
Correct.
What can they do to me? What can they do to you? And I always felt that. Now, the problem is, I always tell you guys, too, we can't whisper and expect change. We have to have
voice. That's our biggest problem. We've been silent with what's going on. And here's an issue, if I can just touch on this briefly, on the perception issue. All right. How many movies have you ever seen that portray a correctional officer in a good light?
Barely.
Okay.
But
the only one.
The Green Mile.
Everyone says that. When I do a lot of public speaking, I always bring that up, right? But who's the worst person in the Green Mile?
Percy,
the correctional officer nonetheless. And isn't it ironic? Now, we look at the Green Mile as saying, okay, that is at least a positive example. Tom Hanks, positive example, right? Okay. But isn't it odd that only in someone's nightmare, in a Stephen King novel, only then are we the good guys? Think about that.
You're right.
All right? When we grew up wanting to be cops. We play cops and robbers. We play cowboys and Indians. We play military. How many kids grew up locking their friends in the basement saying, I want to be a correctional officer? Nobody does that. All right? So from the very beginning of our lives, from the very beginning, from we're a little toddler watching TV, how are correctional officers portrayed? For me, Jane Cagney movies back in the 60s. Right. The real thugs. Look at the Shawshank Redemption. They're up on the roof feeding the inmates alcohol. Come on. It's ridiculous how we're treated. So what I did, what my organization did, is we started at the beginning. Right here. We developed two children's books. My mom's a hero, my mom's a correctional officer, my dad's a hero, my dad's a correctional officer.
Where can
to
I get
change, you got them right here. To change your perception.
Really?
Yeah, those are for you.
Hey, guys, I got two girls.
To change the perceptions. All right, now if you look in the back, let me have this bottom one. If you look in the back of this book, it has, now this, I developed this with a police psychologist from New York. And in the back of the book, you have all these questions and answers. So that when your child has questions about what's in the book, you have a little bit of a study guide as to how to approach it. And this, again, was written by a police psychologist on how to deal with these issues of harm. When your children have to look at you and know that you have a pretty dangerous job.
I got chills right now.
This has been something...
I absolutely got... As soon as I saw the last page, I would love for my daughter, my dad's a hero, my dad's a correctional officer. We never see that.
That's right. So how do we change perception? You don't change at the top because they've got 50, 30, 20 years of baloney that's been fed to them about who we are and what we do. So you start at the beginning. You start with the children of the officers so that they know growing up they can be proud of what we do. So that we can go home at night and be proud of taking that uniform off. And be even prouder in the morning when we put it on. So our children know who we are and what we do. And that's very important to us moving forward. If we're going to change the perception, we have to change it in the beginning.
Can we just mention the authors here? So
sure.
We got my dad's a hero, my dad's a correctional officer, my mom's a hero, my mom's a correctional officer, and it's by Gary
O'Miller. Gary is a PhD. He's a police psychologist out of New York, out of Long Island. I work with Gary in developing the book. We funded the whole thing, ACOIN, and we've been distributing these around the country. So please, also, what we did is we donated 1,500 of these to the Medal of Honor. So if you purchase these, the money goes directly to the Medal of Honor. So it helps them as well.
And we're going to get into the Medal of Honor, but two more authors just say, and Daniel Goldfarb, and illustrations by Fran Pfau.
Yep.
You said I can have these?
Absolutely. These are a few I brought.
Hey, guys, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to have a reading list. I'm going to read these books to you in the next episode of Tear Talk. Okay, so I want to move forward. I want to discuss the Medal of Honor. So, guys, just again, if you're interested in the American Correctional Officer Intelligence Network, I say that correct?
That's right.
All right. Please email him, see how you can get involved. That's the beginning of where we need to be. So, guys, if you want to make that change, you want to be more than just a whisper, this has given us the venue to do that. Now I want to move forward to the Medal of Honor ceremony that we're going to be having in Oklahoma City. All right, so now I want to discuss the Medal of Honor, which I'm actually, again, excited to be a part of. I was invited to be a keynote speaker, so again, that humbles me. I want to give you guys a little bit of the specifics, so I'm going to read right off the flyer here. And this is also in conjunction with the One Voice Leadership, which we kind of were talking about, we touched on, but we're going to do a little bit more. And that comes out of Michigan, correct?
Right, that's working with the guys in Michigan with the SEIU Union, and Andy Potter, the executive director there, and Jeremy Tripp, the legislative aide. They put together the One Voice Initiative. They contacted me because of my networking across the country to reach out to different union leaders around the nation and different correctional officers to get together for this meeting.
Yeah, guys, if you were interested, I have a pamphlet here, One Voice, a National Campaign to Seize New Ground in the Criminal Justice Movement. It talks about policy proposals and principles written by Jeremy Tripp, Simon Greer, and Corey Post, and it's forwarded by Andy Potter, who is the founder of One Voice. He's the executive director, Michigan Corrections Organization, SEIU Local 526M. I've actually spoken at Mr. Potter before.
Yeah, Andy's a great guy.
Yeah, very well-informed and definitely dedicated to the mission of trying to give us that one voice. Again, and this kind of stems from what we've always talked about, where if you can't speak up, I could speak up for you. Give me the baton, pass it forward, I'll continue the run. And this book covers a lot of stuff, including, guys, stuff that you're familiar with, like national concerns. We touched on understaffing, training, officer wellness, the physical environment, overcrowding, some really good information, some really good statistics. It even covers the other side of corrections outside of safety and security, the rehabilitation aspect, the how inmates are classified, programs, the elimination of privatization, which we all agree, you know, you're doing things for profit, you're not doing things for safety and security. So again, if you're interested in this book, there's going to be an email that's going to come across your way at the end. Please, guys, email Brian Dawe if you're interested in trying to see how you can become a part of One Voice, Uniting Corrections. I like that. So let's go into One Voice actually real quick.
Sure.
So what's this about? You got the phone call. How did? Let's go with
I've worked with the Michigan Corrections Organization for years. I've worked with many organizations around the country. Andy is well aware of the network that we had set up, and very much on the same line we've been speaking about is these national concerns that we've had. The difference with Andy's approach and the way the One Voice is approaching this is there are multiple stakeholders in corrections. It's not just correctional officers, and we can't keep coming at it from one angle. We can't just keep coming at it from, this is how we feel. We have to incorporate other stakeholders in what's going on behind the walls. I'll give you a prime example of this. I have minutes from a meeting the inmates had in the state of New Hampshire with the Department of Corrections. It's their regular monthly meeting that the inmates have with the department. You know what their number one concern was? Number one concern of the inmates, understaffing.
Oh, really?
That was their number one concern. And why is that?
Protection,
programming, visitations, mail, meals, all of that stuff is impacted. So that's what I mean by a shared concern. So the inmates want to have more staff. We want to have more staff. Now, that doesn't mean we're together. That just means we have a mutual interest in a certain aspect of correction that we both can benefit from if it's addressed.
Can I mention something just in line with that?
Sure.
Guys, I did it. MSNBC, I was on Al Sharpton's show, and there was a reason why, because I felt that at that time there was a similar interest with what the inmates wanted and what we wanted, especially in regards to privatization.
Mm-hmm.
Believe it or not, the inmates want to feel safe and secure. And in order for us to do that, we got to have the staff to make that happen. So understaffing, dealing with those concerns definitely will help out with other concerns across the board. So maybe it is time that we look to see where these concerns meet.
Exactly. And some of those issues are formed in this policy book, and that's what Andy and Jeremy and the group have been
doing.
And
does that create your angle on how you approach it now?
Yes. It allows us to go down both sides of the aisle and talk to Democrats, Republicans, Independents, our whole issue here is public safety and the safety of the men and women that work behind those walls and live behind those walls.
Right.
Because if it's dangerous for them, it's dangerous for us. You know, we all want to make sure these institutions run smoothly. Meals are a great example, all right? We want the inmates to have good food. Does that mean we're inmate lovers and we want to hug them all? No. That means we think they should have it from a moral standpoint. They should have decent food, but also it protects us and protects them. It's a safer environment. And that's a very simple issue. But it's an issue that has great implications. Because you know you well. They tell you when you come to the academy, don't mess with the food, don't mess with the visits, don't mess with the mail. If you have a problem with those three, you're going to have a problem with the inmate population. Those are three very, very important things to the population that has to live there. So that's a universal concern.
And can I say something that's funny? Because the outside, sometimes they go both ways. They don't realize there's certain things that are given to inmates help us maintain control.
Exactly.
If they had nothing,
that's right.
We have no way to control.
We have no control.
Right.
We need those things. We need the programs.
I agree.
The visitations. We need these things to occupy that downtime. If they're not occupied with something else, they're going to be occupied with messing with us.
Right.
And none of us want that.
Right.
And they don't want that.
I mean,
when you talk to the inmates, they'll tell you individually, sure, there's some big problems in there. We know that. These aren't great guys. I'm not standing up for the inmates. I'm standing up for the officers, but what we're looking for is those unique issues where multiple stakeholders can approach our legislators and get real change.
Right, and if I may add, the reason why people may not understand is our worlds are so connected with those inmate populations.
That's
that
right.
We have to realize that the impact of certain changes can affect both. So we have to be sure that when we do something that's powerful, we have to look at it. How is it going to affect both sides?
That's right.
How this will affect.
Because we're going to have to do a blowback.
Right,
we're going to deal with the blowback.
And it's us that deals with, like,
that's right.
Remember, even though it was a great move, don't get me wrong, it was a great move in my opinion to cancel smoking inside the facilities.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a smoker. I thought that was
a great move.
But it was very important how we implemented that. We didn't want to just tell the inmates, hey, no more smoking tomorrow. It had to be some people like, oh, you should do it quick. No, it's got to be something gradual because you have an officer in there that's going to have to regulate that. And now you have
that's
the inmates
correct.
Getting ready to unite because they share that same.
That's right. That same commonality, that same interest. There's a perfect example of ACLIN. When they started doing the smoking thing, I had all kinds of questions.
Right.
So what I got was all the different policies that were going out, and I sent them out to everybody so they could look and say what's going to work best at our institution.
Knowing how that order has to be delivered out.
Has to be delivered. So how are we going to do it best with the least repercussion, with the least blowback? And that's what we focused on with ACLIN when that issue took place.
Yeah, I got to tell you something. I know there's people like, oh, just zero.
Just lock them up. Take everything away from them.
They have no idea how the real world works.
They don't. And if they do feel that way and then they're on the job, they've only been on the job for a very short period of time.
Yes. Well, yeah, that's another thing, guys. I mean, at the end of the day, I used to call them fire starters. Yeah. People that you work with that kind of just rile things up and kind of carry that that position that I'm better than everyone. Guys, in the real world, there is always going to be, and again, I'll be honest, there is going to be a compromise. Because, you know, if they respect you, they'll respect what has to be done.
Understand this if you're going to be a correctional officer. You only go home because they let you.
Yeah.
Period.
Yep.
That's the real deal behind those walls. I worked in a housing unit 66 to 1. I'd be an idiot to think I could walk out that door unless they let me.
Right. And that's a very strong point. That's why we want to make sure that the things we do don't unite inmates in a negative cause. I mean, right now you have these
don't give them
people
a cause
from
to
the
let
outside
it's
pushing
like
these strikes
strike,
and all
right?
this other stuff, not realizing how that affects us with the numbers. Because right now, we can deal with isolated issues. But now, when you're on the outside pushing these inmates together, now these issues are no longer isolated, and now they become
universal.
And if you look at just an example, the protests on the streets, they turn out to be what? Riots. Now you bring in that inside the wall, and the one officer is no longer dealing with one or two or three inmates with an isolated concern. Now they all have that concern, right. And the officer becomes overwhelmed.
You give them a cause celeb. You give them a reason to unite. And we can't do that anymore. We have to be smart about how we implement policies and the way we do that. And so it's important that we share information with these other shareholders, these other stakeholders that are directly impacted by this. So it's a different, unique approach, but I think it's a great approach, and it's long overdue. We have to get over this macho image of it's us against them. We're all in there.
So one voice is pretty much, so what are the main differences then, again, just between one voice and the American Correctional Officer Intelligence Network?
Okay, we deal strictly with the officers themselves,
right,
and getting intelligence on the ground from the officers.
Okay.
That's our main focus there, is making sure that we share best practices.
And you found that there's a way to work that with the one voice?
Absolutely. Yeah, these guys have been terrific. Their main focus, obviously, is officers. It's all about the officers. It's all about public safety. It's not about the inmates.
But they're trying to
blend
that perspective.
But they're trying to make sure, right, when the issues join, when the issues meet, and the issues impact everybody, we want to have a voice on that.
Okay.
And the whole thing is about having that voice and making sure that people understand, because no one knows what we go through. No one understands what we're going through behind those walls. If we don't have that voice, if we don't have the opportunity to sit down with our legislatures, with our policymakers, and we haven't to this point, if we don't have those opportunities, we can never expect change. And we have to have that type of voice.
And I got to tell you something. I always say that if you look at corrections as like a painting, it's security that is the
number
canvas.
One. That's it. Everything,
everything
on.
Else is based on that canvas.
That's
so
right.
I think it's great to let people who are running these programs come in and say how important safety and security is, because I think people right now are thinking programs supersede safety, and that's not the case.
No, safety is number one.
Right?
It has to be.
And the inmates will tell you that, too.
Well, like, it's that way for them.
Yeah. I can't take a program if there's a threat. You know what, guys? Always another similarity. Let's say bullying. If there's a person bullying your kid in school, your kid's not going to be able to learn because they're going to be focused on a threat. That threat is going to come at them at 4 o'clock. Their learning's done. They can't. They're focused on what's going to happen to them at 4 o'clock. Same environment for us. We want to focus on program, but if there's a threat there and you're not giving us a chance to address the threat, nobody's going to get proper rehabilitation,
right,
because their focus is what's going to happen afterwards, not what's happening in the moment.
And the fewer staff we have and the less training we have, the less able we are to handle those situations,
yes,
and have the programming and have the training that we need to make the whole system work.
And that's where that blended perspective comes in. I'll
exactly
tell you right
that's
now,
the point.
You can have inmates and civilian staff alike that runs those programs come up and tell you, we couldn't do it without custody. But again, we still got to get a better network with them. I still feel that we're still working in an isolated manner, but I don't think that's our fault. I think it's politicians making us choose one versus the other when they don't realize that if we want to make this work, we all work together. So if I were you, you guys get a chance, when you go back into those correctional facilities, try to understand the perspective of those that are working around you. See what they're about, and don't let that division from the outside make its way inside, because I really think that a lot of people think that it's isolated. It's rehabilitation or it's safety and security. It's not that, guys. It's always been both. Rehabilitation, safety and security, but knowing that safety and security is that foundation.
That's job one.
Okay, so I want to... So that's a little bit about One Voice.
Mm-hmm.
And again, you guys are interested in that booklet, we can request it from Brian. We'll send another email out.
Now, what we're doing, too, is Andy contacted me now. He knew we have the Medal of Honor. They're big participants. And he thought, what a great opportunity to have a one-voice meeting, because we're going to have labor leaders from all over the country that will be coming to the Medal of Honor to honor these officers. And it's not just restricted to labor leaders, obviously. If you're a correctional officer and you want to come and recognize excellence within your profession, we would love to have you there. Especially if you're in Oklahoma, you can just walk right in the door. But anybody is absolutely welcome to honor our brothers and sisters who have gone above and beyond. It's about recognizing excellence in corrections. People don't know who we are. They don't know what we do. We spent last year sending out information to all 50 states. We sent out information to the 180th largest counties, all letting them know about the Medal of Honor. We had a tremendous response from all over the nation. We have a selection committee that actually is chaired by our New Jersey captain, Eric Speer, and also with Eddie Callahan, who's a Nassau County investigator in New York, and Lisa Marie Fontano, who's a former union facility representative and correctional officer in Connecticut. They made up our selection committee, selected five honorees and a posthumous honoree as well for this year's awards. We're flying in all the winners, all expenses paid, 3 days, 2 nights in Oklahoma City on our behalf. We have a big honor guard coming in, obviously a great keynote speaker with Anthony. And
you're going to be up with me at the same time.
Oh, absolutely.
You need to do this together.
We're very excited about this. It's a great opportunity to really support our profession, to show the members how much we really care about what they
do. I'm going to do it right now. Since I'm the keynote speaker, Brian, I want you up there with me. We're speaking at the same time.
That sounds good to me.
I think this is a great dialogue we're having. I think that we could really feed very good with each other, but your specific knowledge is something. I'm more generalized. You've obviously been doing your research, so maybe together I think we can have a very good impact. So, Brian, since I've been invited as a keynote, I'm asking you for help. Can you also be on?
All right. Be glad to.
Now, actually, I got chills, guys. I'm really feeling good about this event. Hey, okay, so I just want to read something. Then we're going to go a little bit more specific in the Medal of Honor ceremony. But I'm going to show you a picture of this as I'm reading this real quick. But this is One Voice Leadership, which we talked about, is going to be meeting. Is going to be a meeting held in conjunction with the Medal of Honor Awards Week in Oklahoma City. So if you guys decide to go to Oklahoma during this event, I'll give you guys the dates. There's a chance to interact with both One Voice out of Michigan and the American Correctional Officer.
And the Medal of Honor.
Medal of Honor. So you got three groups here.
Yep.
Okay, so October 12th through 13th, 2018, Wyndham Garden Hotel, Oklahoma Airport, Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, $92 per night for up to 4 occupants. Reservations, if you want to make reservations, number is 1-405-685-4000. The event starts Friday, October 12th, which is going to be a meet and greet. That's 6 p.m. to 9 p.m. And then the next day, Saturday, October 13th, it's going to be the Medal of Honors Directors Meeting, 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. One Voice Leadership Meeting and National Survey Result Discussion. That's 1 to 3:30. Cocktail reception, 6 to 7, and the awards banquet, guys, 7 p.m. to 10 o'clock p.m. Registration fee is $99 and covers all 5 events, including the banquet.
And the meal.
And the meal. That's great. So you guys are pretty much covering the cost for a lot of this. I mean,
yeah,
there's no
pretty
way
much.
To...
We pretty much eat it up. And that it all comes from donations. We don't... This organization is 100% volunteer, and every single dollar that comes in is donations from organizations or individuals that care. Every dollar. We don't have any sugar daddies. There's nobody. I have to go. It's one of my hardest jobs, is going around and asking people for money.
Right.
And
that's
this is one of the things we're doing is the next sheet.
I want to get on that. So, real quick, on Saturday afternoon, the One Voice Initiative, sponsored by the Michigan Corrections Organization, is convening a meeting of correctional labor leaders from across the nation to discuss issues impacting our profession as identified in the National Survey of COs. They're going to be discussing overcrowding and understaffing, safety and recruitment issues nationwide, the decarceration and criminal justice reform, what role do we play in this era of reform, consolidation and facility closures, and the renewed interest in private incarceration. I know PA has been closing a lot of facilities, and I know there was a lot of concerns there. We also have the PTSD Catch-22 and rising suicide rates. What can we do to sound the alarm? I do like the SISM teams now. We can talk to that maybe on another show one day.
Sure.
But I do like what we're doing with SISM teams, as long as we're active and we walk around the compound, not wait for people to come to us. So if you have a major incident, they're not going to come. You know that. So if we have a major incident, I like the fact that if we walk around, people will come and they'll talk, and then you can just kind of make a decision. And again, it's people of your peers. That's the cool part. The results of a national survey of correctional officers' concerns of today from the frontline staff, officers' dignity, holding inmates accountable, and the debate on the use of segregation.
That's
very
a big issue for
very
us.
Very hot topic.
There is a real issue where the input of line staff is critical.
Is being ignored.
Totally ignored. That they've lost
Rikers.
Respect. That is a major tool for us. Now, I understand segregation shouldn't be overused. We all understand that.
Right.
We've been in the business. But you can't take that tool away. That's a critical tool in control and maintaining safety and security, not just for us, for the inmates themselves.
Right.
Not only for the inmates' interaction, but for self-harm situations. There's a lot of reasons we need segregation.
Right, and what I don't like is they're taking one incident, like you just mentioned, and generalizing across
and
the board.
Across the
that
board.
Defines it, and it does it. And the problem's happening now is that we're going by that definition and destroying the safety of the facilities. And the thing is, what people don't realize is that when you have inmates that can't be controlled, you have to be able to place them somewhere until you can determine what's the best approach. This way you keep the facility running at normal, you're getting those programs going, but you're also eliminating a potential threat. Because I know for a fact there are going to be inmates that you just can't house with anybody, mm-hmm. but now you're forcing us to house them, and then they assault their cellmate. The family's like, hey, listen, this guy has a history of assaults. Why are you putting him with my husband, my son? You know, but people don't realize that, again, they're taking the one issue that happened in New York, mm-hmm. and they're using that to be this cause and not realizing that it's a generalized issue off of one specific concern, and that's an unfair stereotype.
And there's been no voice to counter that. When those things happen, there's no countervailing voice until now.
That's the key, and that's great, because that's what's needed. And I'm going to tell you something right now, just on that alone. I know for a fact if one voice was to step up and say, hey, we want to talk about segregation and why it's needed, how many of us would join that fight? I know I would. I'm sure you guys would.
But we also need to understand the limitations of it.
Yeah.
And there's where the shared notice of working with other stakeholders go. We have to realize that there is a point where segregation isn't working for that individual anymore. We need to take, as you say,
right,
other actions.
And I agree, and that's where we start talking about mental health concerns. Yes. But also, again,
another big
agreement.
Issue. Why do we have 63% of the inmates entering our facilities today, 63% entering our county jails have mental health issues? Right. How many officers are trained in mental health? There's only one state that has actually in their curriculum, and that's Michigan. No one else that I've ever asked has a mental health block in their curriculum for new officers. It doesn't happen. Yet 63% of who we're dealing
yeah.
with have these issues.
And you know what? You know what's great? Just going on that, that's a concern that we definitely have to address, because we're dealing with those type of concerns every day, and it's good for us to step up and actually see that.
How do we even know if we're not even trained
how
to recognize?
And you know what's fine? Also, talking about isolation, what we did was we look at the concerns. What are people saying? Inmates are left alone. Inmates are not being programmed. But inmates are not getting out of their cells. There's ways we can manage that in segregation. So basically what we're trying to say is that we remove them from general population, but they're not forgotten. Their needs are still met. So people got to stop getting that idea that they're pissing in the dark in these buckets. It's not the case. They're being attended to just in a more controlled environment and still meeting their needs, but a little bit more aggressive and possibly a little bit more of a one-on-one. If and that's how a lot of changes have been made towards segregation. So we got to stop throwing out the word solitary confinement. Even the word segregation, maybe stick to more of a restrictive housing, because
yes.
that's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
It's more of a restrictive housing.
Mm-hmm.
Officers' dignity, we talked about holding inmates accountable. We touched on that. Post-Janus, sticking together and creating a new professional narrative, which is kind of what we're trying to do with the
that's
One Voice,
exactly
I think.
What we're trying to do. Mm-hmm.
And the One Voice, a movement to address these problems on a national and local level. Make your reservations today, and we'll see you in Oklahoma City. And it goes to register today. Go to www.nmohf.org or email us at mohfoundation2018@gmail.com or call us at 609-805-6336. So there's no excuse. If you guys can make this event, there's all the ways to get the contacts so you can come to this event. Now, I know you
too want- many of us talk the talk and don't walk the walk.
That's the problem.
We need to walk the walk. I've been in so many union meetings, and I used to love to do this when I was a union official. Someone would raise their hand and say, we should do this. And I would say, great idea. You're the chair of the committee.
And all of a sudden,
report back to me,
down.
And all of a sudden, no one wants to do anything. Right? We got to stop the talk. We got to stop the walk.
And guys, we see that in our facilities, right? The people that talk and then wind up not doing nothing but expect you to lead the way. It's like, hey, wait a second. We have to do this together, because it's that voice, that collective voice that makes us move
that
forward.
That makes the difference.
Yeah, if we don't have voice. That, nobody listens to the one. They listen to the many.
Right.
Now, I know we got to come close to coming to an end here, so I know there's a couple of things we have left
Let
to
discuss.
Let me
run quickly by you. Here's what we're doing. As I said, the Medal of Honor Foundation is a national nonprofit public charity run by volunteers. We're all volunteers. We're all state county correctional officers, either retired or current. All of us are. The chairman is Ed Sullivan from New Jersey. He's a lieutenant out of New Jersey. He's our chairman. And as I said, all the fundraising we do comes from officers, comes from individuals who want to donate and want to give. As a nonprofit public charity, everything you donate is tax deductible. What we have done is we've got together, you guys football fans, ladies and gentlemen, you guys out there football fans, I'm sure you folks in Philadelphia are, I know the folks in Boston are, I'm sure the folks in Jersey are with all the great teams we've got around. What we've done is we've put together a package for Atlanta, and we can't call it the name the professional league calls it because we'd have to pay naming rights. But what we've got is a football extravaganza taking place in Atlanta in February, 4 days, 3 nights. The prize is worth $19,000, 2 tickets. to the game, between the 20 and 50 yard line, transportation to and from the game, hotel night, air travel, $1,000 vouchers for travel. It's one of the greatest gifts you can get or give. The tickets, they're only 500 printed. That's it. There's only 500. Your chances 1 in 500 are going, and there's only $100 per ticket. So that'll help out the Medal of Honor tremendously, give you a shot at going to the big game in Atlanta in February. You help us out a great deal. And, hey, you may win. It's a $19,000 prize.
Yeah, I just want to mention something before we close. Just got to do it again. So, guys, we talked about the National Honor Society for Corrections. We talked about One Voice out of Michigan. Again, all these things were made available for you. I'll put an email below of how you can reach Brian Dawe. I also want to mention these books. My Dad's a Hero. My Mom's a Hero. Thank you for giving me these books.
My pleasure, Anthony.
I posted this on Facebook. Someone said, Gangi, is there any way they can do my grandpa, my grandma's a hero? Because some people work. They put in 30, 40 years. They wind up having a family. They wind up having kids. And those kids wind up having kids of their own. So maybe that's something that would be pretty interesting, I think. But ultimately, guys, come out to Oklahoma City. You know, if you guys want to come out, come out. We'll have a meet and greet. I'll be doing some interviews over there now to get your concerns out there with this event. Tell us what you think, because we're always looking to move forward, grow a little bit. You guys are the voice, so if there's anything you want us to address, if we don't get it this time, then that gives us a reason to do another event, correct?
That's right.
So, Brian, anything you'd like to say in closing to my guys?
Yeah, I would. You know, I've been in the business for a long time, 36 years. And I can tell you I've been through a lot of incidents, and I'm sure the men and women who are watching the show have also been through theirs. And you know that feeling when you come out the other end, when there's been a disturbance, when something bad has gone down, and you come out the other end and you feel that tightness. You feel that camaraderie with your brother and sister officers. You feel that love, and that's the only way to describe it, is that love. And you feel it behind that walls, and you feel it intensely because you know what you just went through, and you know what you go through every day, and you feel that. Take that love, take that commitment, and take it out from behind the walls. And put it on the street where we can all see it. Be proud of your profession. Be proud of who you are. Be proud of what you do. So few people will do what we do every day. I love every one of you. I'm proud of what we do behind those walls. Stick to it. Be safe. Take care of each other.
Guys, I might as well just give them Brian Dawe, the new host of Tear Talk. I'm done. I appreciate the time and effort. Love you guys, but the show is now Brian.
Thank you, brother.
No, it was great, Brian. Thank you for coming on. Guys, as always, the show is Tear Talk. We do it for you guys, you brave men and women out there that work in that correctional field. So, guys, this is the chance of taking the voice outside of us, you know, outside of
the walls.
Let's go. Come on, guys. Let's go. Let's get into those events.
Because if it doesn't change in the next 5 to 10 years, grab a mirror. Because that's where we need to look.
Oof, powerful. All right, guys, take care, guys. As always, love you guys. Stay safe.